Well, it's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for the invitation. This is, in fact, my first time giving this presentation to a room full of criminologists, so I look forward to hearing some of your insights and contributing to this developing idea. So the central thesis that I am proposing today is that the Anthropocene is fundamentally a problem of security. And of course, when you think of the Anthropocene, when you think of climate change, it brings with it clear security implications. But it also reflects back on a variety of ways in how security has become a central motivating force for planetary change. In more detail, it is our quest for security, our quest for safety, which has given rise to our carbon-intensive societies, right? It is that slow and that complex and also violent structure of global politics that also inhibits our collective action to respond to the problems of the Anthropocene. So everywhere we look, security is now literally embedded in the earth. And our task is not simply to bring security studies like international relations or criminology, not simply to bring those disciplines of security to the geologists who study the Anthropocene, but also to bring deep time and those messy forms of human nature entanglement into security. So that is the task today, and it's a tall one. So the Anthropocene is a term that I'm assuming that most of us in the room are now familiar with. It's been around for a number of years, and I don't want to spend too much time going over it. But essentially, the Anthropocene tells us that the Earth is made up by and for humans. It is essentially humans that are the primary geological force. And on the face of that statement, you might wonder why that's very important. But when you dig a little bit deeper, it's actually quite a radical concept. It's a concept that transforms not simply our study of the Earth, but also our study of the human populations that, you know, inhabit the Earth. So declaring the advent of this new geological age, the Anthropocene, declaring that is not simply then just a measurement of the hard facts of geological changes. It's easy to see those changes. You can measure the Anthropocene via extinction impacts, or you can look at nuclear fallout and see that human actions are having an indelible and lasting effect on the Earth. But the Anthropocene requires us to have an equal shift in our cognition or our cognitive shifts. So we have to incorporate things, new things like relationality and entanglement. So if the Anthropocene tells us about humans being geological agents, it also means that the traditional divide between humans and that external world of nature, that is no longer relevant. And we are found everywhere. We are found with everything. Humans are found in the forests, in the glaciers. We are found in the skies, the oceans, everywhere in between. We humans now alter seasons. We alter the DNA of life-giving organisms. We enact we see whole worlds of being ending, for example, through extinctions. We see whole worlds of being beginning. So we can see how high levels of agricultural waste being dumped into the oceans, that leads to this widespread growth of algae, which leads to a proliferation of zooplankton, which then has a corresponding bloom of jellyfish, which is now a global scourge, all because of human impacts moving on down the chain. All of this is a result of human actions. So what we need to do then is figure out how we can think and how we can act alongside geological scales. This is clearly a very new task for security, or for people that study security. And what I suggest and what many others are also suggesting is that we need to therefore shift our temporal and spatial scales. We need to bring deep time and things both big and small from the cosmological to the quantum into relation with our modern ecological and security predicaments. So all of this comes down then to an argument based upon what we term, my co-author Clifford and I term, an ecological awareness of relationality and care. And both of those things have so far been largely absent from the security disciplines. One of the things that we need to wrap our heads around at the outset of our discussions is the deeply political questions that follow the Anthropocene. The Anthropocene is not simply a geological marker, although of course it is one of those as well, but it is a political question. Now, one of the primary ways that we can sort of parse out that the politics of that of the Anthropocene is through the ongoing debate about its start date, and more particularly who's responsible for its emergence. Now, a lot of criticisms or critiques have argued that the term Anthropocene itself is not sufficient. It implicates all of humanity as a singular force of nature, right? It sort of flattens all of humanity, masking very deep divisions and inequalities on the basis of sex, geography, race, class. So the Anthropocene is not created equally. It was made more specifically by a subset of humans, namely those who have been on the front lines of modernization, white, middle class, and upper class, wealthy males of European descent or heritage. So for those reasons, we're seeing now a whole variety of different labels being thrown in addition to the Anthropocene. It's quite creatively. You have calls now for something called the Capitalocene, which is meant to emphasize the role of capitalism and technology in creating the Anthropocene. Maybe the Anthropocene should be called the Eurocene. Maybe it should be called the Oliganthropocene or the Manthropocene instead of simply the Anthropocene. So beyond the question of who is responsible, we also need to talk about when the debate on when it started. There are two main markers for this. One is two main markers that are interesting on a political level. The first option is around the term the Great Acceleration, and that refers in geological terms to the unprecedented and major expansions in human populations, together with the creation of long-lasting materials, from minerals to plastics to persistent organic pollutants. So the marker for that, this great acceleration, has been pegged as the global fallout from nuclear bomb tests. So we can measure now the radionuclide fallout captured in tree rings and glacial ice. And studying that, you peg the date of the Anthropocene starting at 1964. And that's because that is the culmination of nuclear bomb tests around the world. It's the peak year of radioactivity. So maybe that's the year the Anthropocene began. Another option, which is also interesting, comes in the form of what's termed the Orbis Hypothesis. And this settles the Anthropocene as starting at the year 1610. Why 1610? Well, geologically speaking, it represents the spike dip, the dip in atmospheric CO2, reflecting a low point in a decades-long dip in CO2 that was caused by the deaths of upwards of 61 million people in the Americas. So it's the annihilation of the Native American population, which caused a significant decline in farming and other human activities. So that reduced pre-industrial CO2 levels to the lowest levels in 2,000 years. So that's a global marker that we can still see, and it represents the first global trading network, or the illustration of that trading network. Something that connected Asia, Africa, the Americas, and Europe, of course. And it also encompasses this Columbian exchange of biota and other flora and fauna, etc. So both the nuclear fallout hypothesis or the Orbis hypothesis are really deeply political. It reflects how social processes are now have real lasting effects on the Earth itself. So the Earth is now a reflection of security in a way, or our pursuit of security. And with that pursuit comes the unequal power relationships, the economic growth, globalized trade. All of these are determining factors in the Anthropocene. So the Anthropocene clearly entangles political, economic, cultural, technological, material processes. This it necessarily bridges often divided discourses of social sciences, humanities, and brings it into the natural sciences. So that's a lot of heavy words about why this really matters. What we need to now do is start talking about how do we reconstruct our approaches to security on this basis, on this new awareness. And there are a few ways to do this, and of course I don't have nearly enough time to go through all of them, but I've reduced it essentially to two main components. One is the pursuit or the acknowledgement of a post-natural security together with the notions of post-human security. So what does it mean to speak of the end of nature? That's one of the sort of ordering questions that is that brings the Anthropocene into security. Now, this is a provocative topic, one that a lot of people have spoken of for many, many decades. And it's really about the breakdown of our Western tradition of viewing man as a master over nature. The belief that human progress is, our progress is dependent upon exploiting nature's resources. And we have generally a mood of indifference to the natural world around us. Many books talk about the end of nature, and these have emerged along with the onset of climate change, our awareness of climate change. But these have basically, up until now, missed the point about what the end of nature means. We have a lot of authors and studies that sort of bemoan this loss of a pristine wilderness, you know, the encroachment of urban spaces upon, this sort of untouched landscape, and how everything is now different from what it would be naturally. And the Earth, by virtue of that, is considered a natural thing. But the Anthropocene tells us that's a kind of a misplaced idea itself. It forces us to chase constantly moving objects, always searching for that pristine, that sort of Shangri-La of like pristine nature. But that nature, the Anthropocene teaches us, never actually existed. And we can look at advances in complexity theory and cosmology, all these sorts of other disciplines, to look at how we need to see ourselves as post-natural beings, or as entangled humans and the world. So we need to avoid what Alfred North Whitehead referred to as this vicious bifurcation of mind and matter, or of human and nature. And we need to sort of get rid of this fallacy of misplaced concreteness, that the world actually does exist as a pristine, unmoving object. And I think international relations and criminology, to an extent, are guilty of perpetuating that stereotype. I know within international relations, the environment is interesting in only so far as it compels or inhibits the violent actions of state, primarily nation states. Beyond that, the environment is of no consequence. But the Anthropocene tells us that's a mistaken view. We actually live in a very entangled universe, one that is constantly undergoing a process of creative becoming. So humans, of course, are not the only species that transforms a landscape. The Anthropocene, of course, says that we are by far the most significant, or we are exceptional in terms of our impacts. But strangely, or in a sort of weird contradiction, it tells us that humans that we are required to break down this ontological dualism between humans and nature. That is something that brings with it so much environmental damage. Another component that I wanted to speak briefly about, and I think this might also speak to some of the criminological aspects of this work, is this focus on the state of nature. That is another way that we often view the natural world, right? That if humans are reduced to their primal or their primitive being, that natural state, then that is sort of an exemplary or an example of purity, as something that reflects trueness or realness. And in international relations, we often use, Hobbes's dictum or maxim that human nature is essentially, basically, it nasty, brutish, solitary. Forget the exact quote, but it's along those lines. We all know it. And that is essentially what human nature is about. And we've, from there, constructed these moral and political programs based upon that view. Because of that, that is why we don't have any remarkable insight into things like droughts or hurricanes or lithium mine pits or nuclear fallout. Those are things that don't really concern us. Now, obviously, they sometimes might be sites of political contestation, but trying to incorporate that into our analysis, into those things into our analysis, is really, really difficult. But unfortunately, I think it's something that we're going to have to try and learn to do. Because the Anthropocene, again, is telling us that there is a breakdown between the division, the breakdown of the division between the natural order and the social and our social lives. We are heterogeneous compositions. We are forged out of these complex shifting factors, these human and both human and physical ingredients. So we have to therefore really try and figure out what it means to blur the line between humans and nature. This concept of self and other really does fade away. So another way that we can actually talk about this is comes in the form of new materialism and post-human security. I won't speak too much on this, but there is a budding movement to really acknowledge that what we even think of as humans or as individual agents is misguided, misplaced, or simply false. So there have been a few books written in the past couple years that try and make sense of what it means to say post-human security. How do we incorporate non-human things, or non-human materials, or non-human ideas into our analysis of security? I know in international relations we have what's termed the materialist turn, and trying to bring trying to expose how these strange assemblages of things that are human and non-human, how those actually configure or impact our understandings of war, of diplomacy, of security, and the economy. So there's a quote from Mark Salter at the University of Ottawa in his latest volume. It's a two-volume series called Making Things International. He says that security cannot be understood solely as a set of speech acts, but it also requires guns, tanks, drones, tear gas, badges, and fences. In each of these areas, there are non-human actants that fundamentally alter the condition of human possibility in ways that are unpredictable and irreducible to their constituent elements. So trying to think of ways in which materials actually, or non-human materials actually impact our studies and practices of security is one of the ways in which we can start to acknowledge these type of Anthropocene thinking. Another way of thinking about this is focusing on the hybrid forms of human life. Humans themselves are heterogeneous compositions. We are composed and affected by microbes, non-human things that exist in tandem with our own bodies. Now, all of and also our relationships with animals. You can talk about the use of the war horse, for instance, as Stephen Hobden and Erica Cudworth do But this doesn't mean we need to reorient our hierarchy, our ethical or moral hierarchy of humans being placed at the top of ethical consideration. It doesn't mean that we need to move beyond anthropocentrism. That would be impossible to do anyway. But we do need to see humans as more ambiguous beings, as things that are seeing us as existing in tandem, combined with non-human, with non-humans. So all of this viewing ourselves as interacting actants, and some of those actants are non-human or inhuman. Some of them are not even alive. So these are two primary ways of reconstructing security. Another way is also talking about the problems of extinction. Now, this is something that in our book we talk a little bit about because we found it to be a really anchoring principle of security. Because security is nothing if not the quest for survival, right? And if that's one of the discipline's core concerns, namely the pursuit of safety and the pursuit of survival, what happens when unpredictable climate change and other effects of the Anthropocene forces us, we're confronted with extinction events across species and how that connection bears onto us real existential risks that we cannot control. So this is a troubling sort of component of the work, is understanding that we have probably entered what is termed the sixth great extinction. Elizabeth Colbert wrote a fantastic book titled that. And we are therefore on the cusp of a great dying, or at the beginning of it, a mass extinction event that hasn't actually been seen in 56 million years. So, since by the end of this century, we're probably going to be existing in a world that is 2 to 4 degrees warmer than it currently is, and that's despite the pledges given at the latest COP meeting in Paris, which said that they'd like to limit it to 1.5 degrees. What comes with this new world that essentially we're creating is an increase in the severity and number of extreme weather events. We're talking droughts, heat waves, hurricanes, etc., and a corresponding loss in biodiversity. And ecosystems as a result are at the risk of abrupt and irreversible changes. So these are so-called tipping points that leads to the loss of human life and cultural heritage, and also catastrophes on a much, much larger scale, including the failure to maintain life, human life. So thinking about this is, as I said, really troubling, but it's also something that we can no longer ignore for those of us in the security business. Extinction rates are 1,000 times higher than they have been, than the normal background rates of extinction, 1,000 times. And they're likely to grow to 10,000 times. The last time we were in the midst of an extinction event of such magnitude was about 56 million years ago. And that was the result of a meteor impact and corresponding volcanism. So that had the result of that, as we probably know, is that about 75% of all species on Earth perished as a result of that. And this is when the dinosaurs sort of left us. And the main change, of course, is that now we are the driving forces of that change. And figuring out, well, what's that going to mean on geological scales and on a social scale is really problematic. So this means that we have to start confronting the impacts of all of our mental models that we base our societies around. And on a very minute level, for people like me and you in this room who are interested in this in the security problematique, which is ensuring the promise of safety, ensuring the promise of survival, what does it mean in an age of extinction? It means that we have to start dealing with the prospect of failure and the experience of failure for many beings, things that do not survive. And it means that we have to look past this universalization of threats and of emergencies and try and incorporate plurality, entanglement, risks, emergencies. These things that are slow, dim, but violently effective. So all of this means that we need to start talking about extinction, which is not an easy thing to comprehend, or that is often easy to do. But it means that it's doesn't mean that it's not ongoing, and that the world that we perceive to be everlasting is one that is constantly changing, constantly eruptive, and something that will disrupt our own societies. So thinking about what it means when the melting of the Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets and the subsequent raising of sea levels by upwards of 70 meters. That's a huge thing. That's clearly a major emergency, but one that exists, that has a corresponding multiplicity of tinier emergencies than that subsequent event, right? This is an event that is ongoing, that does not exist in one exceptional catastrophe. So how do we make sense of that? This is talking about multiple extinctions and trying to overcome these problems of individual agency or societal agency. One of the more interesting components is the Svalbard seed vault, which is used in our book as a sort of example of how we have confronted extinction on in the security disciplines. Now, I have a few minutes left, and I want to talk briefly about this response that we try and that we basically end on in this book, and that is on the ethics of care. It's meant to answer the question, under what conditions do we or can we pursue security in the Anthropocene? It is clear that to replicate or repeat our previous practices and ideas of security would leave us probably doomed, but to conceive of anything else is almost impossible. So we don't try and offer a blueprint or some type of plan of action for righting the ship, so-called. The Anthropocene doesn't allow it, but we're also equally unpersuaded by nihilism or despair, those things that actually are the buzzwords of security we don't think are very useful for us in the Anthropocene. So thinking about a shared threat, which is what the Anthropocene is, it may not be equally created, but it certainly does threaten us all, of course not equally either. But instead of focusing on tragedy, what we need to do is start thinking about how to be careful or how to act with care. And I think this is a really provocative and promising avenue. Now, the ethics of care, for some of us who might already know, it's a well-developed ethical program that comes from us primarily via feminism or feminist security studies. And what it's meant to do is emphasize material everyday insecurities. So rather than focus on the spectacular moments of danger, spectacular moments of the breakdown of social safety and the danger and violence that corresponds with that, we look to the marginalized sites of insecurity. So rather than focusing on securitization as a state of exception, we see the relentless insecurities of the unexceptional. And care ethics provides an alternative to these atomistic theories of virtue or of ethical virtue, which is so prevalent in security studies. You know, this emphasis on righteousness, on honorable action, on intelligence, detachment, all of those things are sort of are troubled by this care ethics program. And it's premised upon the importance of attentiveness, the importance of giving, of hospitality and empathy. And all of these practices are given in relation, because it acknowledges that all of us are beings in relation. So this is why care ethics is so important. It doesn't offer us a universal moral prescription. It bypasses the divide between the local and the global. The everyday realm of the household, for instance, is a constant site of insecurity for many, many people, particularly women. in many ways, that's also an unremarkable place, just like the Anthropocene tells us is important. Another way is that care is essential for all of our survival. We have all experienced care. We have all probably given care at some point in our lives. We all exist today because someone has cared for us. To speak of survival, then, is to speak of empathy on a base level, to think of a responsiveness and of compassion. And lastly, I want to say that care ethics emphasizes non-reciprocity, which I think is an important component. Why is that important? It's because the world is indifferent to us. The world doesn't care, but we have to care for it and for ourselves within it. We need to learn to act without promises. And if security is only about promises, then it means nothing in the age of the Anthropocene. Because we certainly cannot predict the future. And oftentimes, as the tipping points argument makes, it sometimes doesn't matter what we do. We need to prepare for a world that is vastly different than what we have now. So in conclusion, I want to say, in the words of Latour, that we are all climate skeptics, and I think we need to acknowledge this. Regardless of whether or not we are enlightened in terms of our awareness of the climate problem, we still act in all states of relative denial, states of indecision, and of ignorance. And part of the problem is because the Anthropocene is what Timothy Morton refers to as a hyper-object, something that is massively distributed. We cannot, unless you're a geologist, we cannot wake up to and point to the Anthropocene and say, there it is. In the same way that we talk about climate change, we only see pieces of it at a given moment, at a given time. But the Anthropocene is a problem of and for security. It reflects the numerous failings of the contemporary interstate system and the ongoing denial of the effects of the carbon economy that emanate from it. So I think both international relations and criminology have contributed much to our understanding of, you know, why it's so difficult to build responses to environmental crimes or environmental harms, or talking about the role of climate change in conflict. Those are things that I think both of our disciplines do very well. But we need to start thinking bigger and start questioning the foundations of our knowledge and our actions. Because the Anthropocene points us to something much more complex and disquieting, this myopic tendency to view humans and nature, security as the divisible strata that we only encounter instrumentally. So this reflects old forms of modernism, old forms of materialism, things that have helped contribute to the crisis at hand. So overcoming this myopic tendency of ours, I think, will be the central task for security scholars for years to come. I will conclude on that note. So thank you very much.